So this lecture is entitled Getting to Know You, like the famous song from The King and I. And I've been told that absolutely, positively, I cannot sing. So therefore, I'm just going to describe the title and just say that just like that song is one of the key elements, if not the key element to that famous musical, getting a good patient history is the key to good patient care as well. That's my intro. Let's talk about it. So why do patient histories matter? It really is the crux of providing the right diagnosis for a patient, and then eventually getting the right treatment on board as well. So this is a study of looking at internal medicine faculty and residents, and they were asked, what's the most important element in making a diagnosis? Is it the physical examination? Of course, we do physical examination on every patient. Is that really where the diagnosis gets made? Or is it an ancillary testing, and that's lab, x-ray, other forms of testing that we may do? The majority of these faculty and residents believed it was in the history, and I believe that too. Patients often know their diagnosis, and it's just a question of me helping guide them to where it is. It's really amazing to see that. And of course, when patients have a belief and an understanding of their own diagnosis, it makes enlistment in a plan of care a heck of a lot easier. So how do you get started with a patient? I tend to be a pretty enthusiastic guy. I really like my job and I love patient care. And if I could come in there and just bounce right in and say, good morning, I'm Dr. Vega. Pleasure to meet you today. I do. A lot of my patients, they're sick. They don't feel very good. Many have depression or other serious stressors in their life. So I really want to make my entire visit about being positive and constructive so that we can do something positive together as a unit, patient and physician. One question that I should ask more often than I do is, how would you like to be addressed? That's a really nice way to open, especially for a patient whom you don't know. Ask them what they would like to be called. For younger patients, they may want to use their first name. Certainly, anybody under the age of 21, I tend to use their first name. But a lot of my patients in my practice are older, and I always address them as Mr. or Mrs. And that's just the way I was raised, to be respectful like that. But some people might like to change that paradigm. Ask them how they would like to be addressed. It's a really nice way to open a conversation. Very important that this has actually been studied. Most patients like to shake hands with their physician. So how do you mitigate that with this imperative that we should always keep our hands clean? I like to shake hands and then later I'll put my hands down and then wash my hands before examining the patient. But this is particularly important for minority patients because it's a sign of respect. It's a sign of universal respect and connection. I'm going to shake your hand. And then just start with a real open question. What brings you to the clinic or emergency room or hospital today? So this slide shows a physician saying, with his finger in the air for some reason, saying, tell me more about. And that's a really key phrase because, again, the patient often wants to elaborate their history. You want to give them a space that's safe to speak, and you want to show that you're listening. And just letting them tell their story is the real key to a good history. So say the patient says, oh, I've got a terrible pain in my stomach. A nice response is, tell me more about the pain. It feels like a bad cramp. So it's a crampy pain. How else can you describe the pain? Let's just dissect that statement for a second. So first, I reflected to the patient, oh, so I hear you, it's a crampy pain. It also kind of puts it in a category in my mind, crampy pain, because I'm thinking as I'm talking to the patient, I'm starting to form my differential diagnosis. But it's not enough, right? We want to know more about the pain, and we want the patient to put it in her or his own words. So how else can you describe the pain is a nice open way to do that. So follow the patient's leads. It's really terrible. I've seen patients who break out crying and physicians are still going through a review of systems checklists like, and do you have fever? And do you have headache? And is your hair dry or falling out? And the patient's crying in front of them. It's really terrible. So as the patient's going, react to the patient. That's what empathy is all about. But having empathy is enough. You have to act upon it. Certainly also when you hear something unusual or possibly highly pertinent in a patient's history, make sure you react to that too. So in this case of abdominal pain, the patient says it hurts more when I eat. It all started when I eat some strange when I ate some strange food. Wait a minute, strange food, what? Just tell me more about that. What exactly were you eating out there? That's really important. So use the patient to help navigate their own history. And then I'm a big believer in using continuers. Things, just simple statements. Oh, I see. Tell me more. Go on. And the famous, mm-hmm. Better than that, just maybe use silence. Just, you're smiling, slightly. You're nodding. Silence is weird, right? So a good trick to play the next time you have a family gathering is just be silent and let people tell their story, and then you're engaged. And it's amazing how uncomfortable people get, or when you're out with your friends or whatever. Silence is a great way to get more history in and of itself. And I'm the master of silence. I've actually had people try that on me before, and I know what they're doing, and so therefore I'll just be silent back. And it can be turned pretty funny, and I always win. Ask directly what the patient has as well. It's important for a couple reasons. As I said, sometimes they've done research online, and so they have an idea what their diagnosis is. Sometimes my patients have a concern that's way out there. Like I've had abdominal pain for one day with some loose stool and feeling malaise, and I think it's cancer. You know, it's most likely not cancer, right? But it gets that issue out there. So that you can address it, because of course you're going to reassure the patient at the end that it's probably gastroenteritis or something related like that, and not a terrible diagnosis like cancer. So asking directly is a great idea. In terms of getting all the facts, sometimes you have to ask close-ended questions, not those open-ended questions like tell me more about your pain, or give me a location for your pain, can you point to where it is? You have to ask specific things. Does the pain radiate, for example? Have you tried anything to alleviate the pain? I like when we talk about palliative factors, which is any things that relieve symptoms like pain, is use anything. Because patients try all kinds of things. Certainly think about, okay, have you tried any medications? But they might also be doing some kind of massage or using a topical treatment. They might be jumping up and down on the stairs. You never know. And it's important to get all those things out there, because maybe it's the jump, it's the medication you prescribed isn't helping, but jumping up and down on the stairs is. I'm gonna have them jump up and down the stairs a few times. It's gonna be better probably than the side effects that my medications can bring along. All right, and you can always go back to open-ended questions. So for example, after you asked if the pain radiated, do you have any other symptoms when the pain comes? Open-ended, no. Well, I need to know a couple specific things here, so I'm going to ask the patient, specifically, do you feel nauseous? Or have you had fever? Notice how I separated those two questions? Because it's very important that you don't want to inquire into more than two symptoms with one question. You never want to create a laundry list. And if you had fever, back pain, have you had loose stools or numbness in your legs or feet? I mean, the patient is just, what's the answer going to be? No. Why? Because they can't really remember what the first or the third thing you said, and therefore you're not getting a very accurate history in that case. So really just simple statements, try to avoid jargon, and make it just one symptom per question. And then how did I ask the questions was also important. You don't want to say something like, you don't have fever, do you? Because what's the patient going to say to that? No, because it sounds like they're bad if they had fever. Instead, have you had fever? Objective, open, no matter what kind of history you're talking about, and particularly with more sensitive forms of history. Say you're asking about the use of substances, or you're taking a sexual history. Then you really want to maintain objectivity and use language that's very neutral.